going today, on behalf of my pastor, Pastor Norbert Onaga, and on behalf of our senior pastor, Pastor David Obwele, praise the Lord. You are very, very welcome in the name of Jesus. But I also welcome you above all on behalf of Jesus, the Son of the Living God, the Living Jesus Christ in the house. Hallelujah. Welcome to our trip people to church, and you may be seated. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. The month of December is the 12th month of the year. And one of the things the number 12 stands for, because there are several things that it stands for. It's establishment. Someone say establishment. You know, when God spoke to Abraham that he was going to make a nation through him, when he was alone, that nation was not yet formed. When his son Isaac was born, that nation was still a dream. When Isaac had his two sons, that nation was still in formation. But by the time that Jacob had 12 sons, praise the Lord, that nation came into fruition, praise the Lord. So 12 is the number of establishment. Someone say establishment. If you also want to look at it technically, 12 is a number of structures and systems. Structures and systems. So, when you get to that stage of 12, you are setting a system for taking any nation. That's why Jesus had 12 disciples. Because it's a number of establishments, so it's establishment. Once he was able to get 12 disciples, he was ready to take the world. Our pastor would always say, give me 12 men and I'll take any nation. Any nation. The number 12 also stands for government. It's actually the government of God. It's always defined by 12. The government of God is always defined by the number 12. So 12 also stands for dominion. Because when you have governance, you have what? Dominion. So this is your month of establishment. Tell everybody, this is your month of establishment. No, tell the person, this is your month of establishment too. You know, last month we talked about breakthrough. But you know, there are some people after breakthrough, they have breakdown. And after the breakdown, you'll be looking for the breakthrough. But when you have a breakthrough, and that breakthrough leads to establishment, praise the Lord. For instance, many people won the lottery, and 1 year later, they couldn't find the money. But there are one or two people in history that won the lottery and used it to establish companies, praise the Lord. And that was the beginning of their rise. There was a man in my village, Gochuku, you know, Ugofo. I don't know, but that's one of the things. He was an ex-police officer. He said he won the lottery. And with that lottery money, he established a major company in the food chemical industry that shook the nation. At his prime, he had almost half of the houses at Upper River. Had properties in Lagos, everywhere. Got to a point even involved in national politics. Praise the Lord. That's a man that managed his breakthrough well. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Not enough to have breakthrough. The question is, what happens after what? Breakthrough. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
So he went to establish a legacy because he managed his breakthrough well. There are a lot of people that have been able to do that. Some it was a loan they took. Of course, we know the story of Dangote. He took a loan from his uncle. And from there, can see now, has established a company that is shaping the nation. And is the richest black man on the planet. There are so many examples of people like that. But there are many people that took a loan, and after the loan, they needed to be loaned. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Someone say establishment. So 12 is the number of establishment. So one of the things the Lord is asking us to this season is to establish structures to hold the miracles that God is giving you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? For instance, as a church, as we are trusting God to move into the next level, we must establish the structure to retain the blessings, to retain the breakthroughs. One of the reasons Pastor talks why revivals don't last is that whenever a revival starts and you don't establish a structure to manage the harvest, it's just a matter of time. You'll be looking for the impact of what? The revival. But if you look at most of the revivals we've had over the years, some of the ones that have had the greatest impact is the Pentecostal, the Protestant Reformation of the 1500s. That one of them was a lasting impact. Why? That revival led to the building of institutions. They built a lot of schools. And those schools changed the nations. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
And everybody said amen. Amen. They built schools. They reformed governments. And those governments and those schools redefined nations. For instance, the Pentecostal Reformation was part of the thing that gave King Henry V the audacity to break out of the Catholic Church and establish the monarchy of England as an independent monarchy. And in the long run, many monarchies in Europe started taking the same stance. Praise the Lord. Until today, England is a strong, independent country. That's why the Anglican Church is called the Church of England, but they adopted that church as their own. So the church didn't only affect religion, it affected governments. Influence was so strong that some years later, people now started advocating for what they call the separation of church and state. Because church had strong influence on the state. We need to get back there where church still has strong influence on what? The state. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Someone said, it's my season of establishment. You know, one way you have focus for the month is not just for that month. What is happening is that the God is going to use some of the things he will teach you that month to put a foundation in you that will last a lifetime. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
So it's not just something, a seasonal focus. We just focus on it and after that it's over. No, it's a foundation. Someone says it's a foundation. Someone says the foundation. So the things I will be sharing this month, both in the meetings, that's why if you read what I posted this morning on the church WhatsApp page, I say, don't miss any service this month. Then don't miss meetings, because there are things that are not discussed in service. I hear what I'm saying. They are discussed in special meetings. For instance, from tomorrow, we're going to be having what we call a church family meeting, or church family retreat. It's not a relationship program. It's an in-house family meetings where we unveil the deeper dimensions of the focus of the month and show you the practical things, the in-depth things, praise the Lord, that God wants to address that will help us achieve what God has planned. And everybody said amen. The reason why sometimes you have, focus for months and it seems as if nothing happened is that, you know, when it's not enough to give a focus. There are things, there are ingredients. Someone say ingredients.
But
if I want to produce, there isn't ingredients, you know, that if you put together and produce a egusi. If you just talk about a egusi and you don't get the ingredients, what happens is that you don't get to produce it. So whenever we release a theme for the month or theme for the year, there are things that make that thing come to pass. There are things, then there are meetings that make that thing come to what? Come to pass. And everybody said amen. If you don't take those things, if you don't get those ingredients, that month will just pass. You'll have a wonderful thing. Or that year will pass. You'll have a wonderful thing. And yet, nothing will have been put in. For instance, this is the year of covenant possibilities. Do you still remember? Many of you have forgotten. You just enjoyed it in January and forgot it in February. And you have been running without direction. No. That is why if you observe most of the things we have taught this year is on covenant. We started the year by showing you some covenant demands as a new believer. So we started with what we call new covenant or new creation realities. I don't want to go too much into that because of time. But go back and listen to our messages from January. January we talked about vision. From February we talked about unity and synergy. From March we started going into the cross, new creation reality, things that Jesus died for. We did that up until sometime in April, in June, we began to switch. By the time we got to July and then August, we switched. We started dealing with covenant reality. That's why we started dealing with the issue of foundation. Technically, from that July till November, what we have been dealing with is deliverance. It's deliverance that we've been dealing with, deliverance and spiritual warfare. How to enforce your covenant in Christ. And this December, we're still talking about covenant though. We're not talking about how to enjoy the covenant benefits. So don't think we just sleep like you, just wake up like I have on this night. Why I want it. No, there's a plan. Someone say there's a plan.
There's a plan.
There's a plan. And you see nationally and internationally, there's a plan. Because the God that gave the vision has a plan for his implementation. And everybody said amen. Amen. That's why I want to encourage you, don't miss services. The way we call for retreats or some special programs, don't miss it. And you'll be able to get these things and everybody said amen.
Amen.
So what did I say December? It was a month of what? Establishment. Number two is a month of dominion. Then the last thing is a month of, you like this one, enjoyment.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because when you have established dominion, you can enjoy, is it not?
Yes, sir.
Without fear. When your house is properly locked at night, you can do anything you want to do. You can eat, you can sleep. You can lie on the staircase. You can lie in the parlor. True or false? You wouldn't bother. I see God bringing you to the place of enjoyment in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So I'll be sharing with you because this month, if you really want to now put everything in a team, the team, we'll call it the team of the world to be enjoying the goodness of God. Enjoying the goodness of God. Last month we talked about breaking into the promised land. This month now we want to tell you how to enjoy the good things in the promised land. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
Because some people know how to get things, they don't know how to enjoy it. The Bible says that God has given us all things richly to what? To enjoy. A lot of us don't know how to enjoy things. I've met people like that. I used to be like that. We are always walking, never enjoying. Never slow down to sleep. Never slow down to eat. Never slow down to watch TV. Looks like a crime. Never go out. That one I'm repenting. Take your family out. Some of you need to repent. For the first time in your life, take your family
out.
And those of you that are dating, that don't know how to take your family out, you are, they may not come to you. You need to repent 10 times. You should be soaked in blood. Because if you can't take your spouse to be out when you are dating, what will you now do when you are married?
You lock her inside.
So I say, thank you. Tell everybody you must enjoy your life.
You must enjoy your life.
Yes, now. The truth is that one you are, if you don't, so that one is for enjoyment. If you don't enjoy it, somebody will want or waste it. Many men that work very hard, that money they accumulated, they didn't enjoy it. Their children work, wasted it. Please, can you guys, where are the guys that are going to sit here? Sit there, please. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Hello, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Do we see a balanced church? Yes. Very balanced ministry. I learned it from Pastor. Pastor David is one of the hardest working people, but Pastor can enjoy himself. Any good place on earth has gone there. If a pastor comes to your country, if there's any good place, he will go there. He goes to South Africa after preaching. We go to those safaris. You know safari. You know what they call safari? It's not a cloth. You know what is safari? Those game reserves where you watch lion live. All those things, giraffe and all those stuff. You come out. There's one you see. You come out. You see live lion, not paper, not Lion King movie. Lion. How many of you are going to Yankari Game Reserve? Raise your hand. No, let me ask you a question. How many of you have lived in the north? Raise your hand. And you have gone to Yankari Game Reserve. Raise your hand. So you are sinning. It's a sin. There are so many fine places in the north. Where has gone?
I said
okay, you stay. So you've gone to Yankari. Mm-hmm. There's another fine game reserve in the north. What's the other name? I'm trying to remember. I went to Jos. I made sure, I went for a course, but I made sure before I left, I went to the zoo. Because the zoo was very, very popular. Though as at the time I came, it wasn't like it was before. Because when I was younger and I went there, they said they had a section just for elephants. But unfortunately, when I went, I just found, I don't know how many elephants I saw. But I saw some amazing things. I saw some crazy baboons. I saw all kinds of crazy animals there. Roaming free. It's like I'm looking at you. Tell anybody, you need to learn to enjoy your life. Oh. How many of us have ever lived in Akwa Ibom? Raise your hand. Akwa Ibom. Akwa Ibom has more than 200 tourist attractions. Have you gone to anyone? Springs? No, Tinapa is in Calabar. I'm talking about Akwa Ibom State. They have all kinds of springs, waterfalls, all kinds of things. Akwa Ibom. Now, of course, if you go to Cross River, that one is another place altogether. How many of you have lived in Cross River? Have you heard of Obudu Cattle Ranch? Hey. Wait, how many of you have heard of Obudu Cattle Ranch? Raise your hand. How many of you have gone? One. Kalabaya, Kabaya. See, you know, there are places that, for instance, just tell yourself, I will enjoy my life.
I will enjoy my life.
You have to think about it. You have to plan it. For instance, if you visit a city for a course, don't leave the day the course ends. Stay one extra day and go to the market. Go somewhere. Tell the person, take me what? Somewhere. And I go to visit my brother in Abuja. So I say that. Pick me somewhere, get your house, okay, me something. That's why we need to pray for our state, the Enugu state, though. We have some serious problems. When I was young, we used to have zoo. Now we now have zoo estates. I don't know whether the people living there are animals, I don't know, but. Yes. We used to have zoo, now we have what? Zoo estates. So I don't know whether the people living there are what? Animals. They have. We used to go to Abuke. We used to go to the glass industry. How many of you remember? How many of you have been there? The ceramics industry. How many of you have been there? Why you should have been there?
Abuke is
still existing. No, I'm asking how many of you have gone. I must say whether it's existing. Even schools now, I don't know, where did they take children for excursion? Excursion, shopping.
Yeah.
Some of us that are planning to get in government, you need to reestablish, you need to bring back joy to our city. Praise the Lord. Because people in their selfishness have destroyed the things that give people what? Joy. Even if you want to, why not relocate this zoo? There's a lot of land in Enugu where the zoo will be comfortably be. Since you say, you know what, it's down in the metropolis. You can comfortably move it out. There's a lot of land where that zoo could be. I wonder where people go on Christmas Day now, shop right. And spa on Christmas Day to do what? Lick ice cream. That you don't lick on normal days. It's a good one. So I learned that thing from Pastor, and I'm still trying to learn it though. Pastor is good at it. That's why he told us about when they went to a hotel at the Cape of South Africa, Cape Coast. Is at the boundary where the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean meet. The two oceans have different colors. I hope you know.
Yeah.
This one is blue, this one is green. And they just mind their business. I've seen another one, there's a boundary, there's another one where the Pacific Ocean and I think the Atlantic Ocean too meet.
Indian Ocean.
You see, as in, what the Bible say that God set boundary for seas? So we need to plan to go for some of these places. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So Christmas like this, we should plan and go for holiday. Plan and go somewhere. Tell your neighbor you need to enjoy your life.
You need to enjoy your life.
Hello. Am I talking to the right people here?
Yes, sir.
Single guys, it's not to sleep with the girl. No, take her out. Don't take her in. Take her what?
Out.
That girl, Baranyam, Guinea, Christmas. That's what you should do. Let her have fun. Enjoy herself. When you marry, you can take her in.
Yes, sir.
But let me be frank with you. Taking out makes taking in better. I'm coming to married people now. If you're not married, close your ears. When you take out, taking in becomes powerful. I don't know. I'm meant to be preaching here. But I don't think I don't have message. Yo. But this is a good message. It's a good message. Every time it's not casting out demons. You know, last month we dealt with demons. Some of you, the demons are gone and you are still not enjoying your life. You're blaming the devil. When the devil has traveled to Australia, you are bound him in Yugoslavia. You are here blaming him for your dry life. Tell anybody, you need to enjoy your life.
You need to enjoy your life.
Hallelujah. Okay. So let me talk to you briefly about 10 keys to enjoying the goodness of God. 10 keys to enjoy the goodness of God. I'm going to be teaching this over the next, I think, 3 services, most likely. Because another way you can put it is practical secrets for eating the good of the land. Practical keys to eat the good of the land. It's one thing to break into the land. It's another thing to eat the good of the land. It's one thing to break into an industry. You are breaking into the music industry. It's another thing to chop in the music industry. It's one thing to break into ministry. It's another thing to eat of the good in ministry. A lot of people, all they do is to see, but they don't enter. Mm-hmm. You know the Bible says that if you are born again, you shall what? See the kingdom of God. If you are not born again, you shall not see the kingdom of God. But he went ahead to say in John chapter 3, he said, unless you are born of water and of the Spirit, you shall not enter the kingdom of God. Because somebody asked, what is the difference between seeing and entering? Seeing is seeing it. Entering is participating. Someone say participating. If you're not water baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost, you will not enjoy the good things. Because, for instance, tongues is the door into the supernatural. If you walk through the Holy Spirit speaking in other tongues, there are dimensions of the wisdom of God, the power of God, the manifestation of the Spirit you will not see. Are you hearing me? You just be in the corridor of Christianity. So it's like that. A lot of us are like that. We're in the corridor of life. You've broken into the industry. You've broken into the business. You are even working hard, but you are not enjoying the good of the life. But this month, God is going to open an unusual door for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And you're going to begin to enjoy the good of your land in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So what land are we actually talking about? There could be three applications of the word land there. Number one is your promised land. That means your dream, your life aspiration, your dream for life, your vision for life. Could also mean your vocation, your ministry, your business. I don't know about you, but I've already stepped into my life ambition. I'm living my dreams. Yes. Listen up now. I am living my dreams. Because I'm a pastor and I'm a doctor. These are the things I dreamt of. And I'm moving in it. I'm not a junior doctor anymore. Neither am I a junior pastor. I'm a senior resident. I'm a senior pastor. I'm a zonal pastor. But my most qualifications. And there are dimensions I've entered. I've touched on dimensions. I hear what I'm saying. I look back and there are things I dreamt of yesterday. I'm living in them what? Today. I'm living in my dreams. I don't know about you. I am. Many of the things, I can give you books where I wrote these things I'm experiencing now. I was talking to my friend, is it Pastor Adozie? I think he was talking to some people. And he was talking about, okay, was in the meeting, but a lot of the things I'm doing now, like when we're in campus, because we happen to grow up together, we're also roommates at the time, and I used to say those things. In fact, when he decided to develop the website from there, the certain name he used, because that's the name I've written on all my Bibles. All. There are about three names I've written on all my Bibles. Of my assignment. And he knows. And I'm living in it. Tell your neighbor, Pastor is living in his own room. Are you living in your own? Yes, I've not gotten to the height, but I've entered. But now, and I've started chopping small. But I need to chop big. Is anybody with me here?
Yeah.
I need to chop better food. I still remember that. You remember Amina, when you were pregnant, my wife was pregnant, and she came and looked. She said, "Mommy, Yahweh don't chop me." As in, Yahweh has eaten because I chopped better food. Because my wife was, because she knew when we got married, then now she's seeing her with a big tummy, so the little girl, the only thing she could understand that, because I'm eating so much. So I was wondering, what did you eat, baby? I said, you eat Yahweh? You need to chop the food, no? Hallelujah. You know, so many people are so busy chasing the devil, they don't have time to enjoy their life. So people are so paranoid chasing enemies, they don't have time to enjoy their lives. And yet they are really inside the enjoyment, too. But they don't have time. You are free in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Secondly, your promised land, the land we are talking about, can talk about your territory. Your territory. Where you live, where you work, your city, your nation. You have a right to enjoy that territory. You have a right to eat the good in that territory. You know, many people say things about Nigeria. Nigeria is so bad. The economy is so terrible. People are dying of hunger. Kalaba story. In that your city, houses are rising, true or false? Every empty land, people are building. Even some places, there's one place, I don't know what they're doing towards Phoenix. It looks like I don't know whether it's a fast food or something. That you notice what is happening there. They have been doing it in secret, now they're opening. And you are complaining. There's one in this land though. Some people are seeing that, some people are chopping. Could you believe that most of the foreign flights out of this country have been booked from now to February. Most, I'm talking about almost 80%. Someone was trying to book a flight out to one of the countries in North America. If all the economy seats booked, what is remaining now is business class. So when you look at the fare, 1.2 million, 1.3, 1.5, 1.6 million, they booked, and you see there's no money here. You are joking. There's no one, I remember someone told me, a pastor needed a return flight from Abuja to Enugu. All of them booked from now to December. Flight from Abuja to Enugu booked on most of the airlines. And you say there's no money. It's only in your street though. Did you hear what I said? It's only where in your streets that there's no money. Can you believe that? Can you believe that? Till February. There's one, the guy that was gotten just to turn like this, someone has collected the seat. 500 and something thousand. I'll collect the seat. The next seat available, 900,000. By the next day, 1.something million. Just to enter plane as it. And not to drive the plane. Or lie down. Sit down it. But there's good in this land though.
Yes.
And I'm going to eat that good in the name of Jesus. If you believe it, shout a living amen.
Amen.
The third land, so your territory, there's good in this land. There's good in this nation. You better believe it. Then the earth, there's good in the earth. And God expects you to eat the good in the land. And everybody said amen. So we'll be studying some biblical keys to eating the good of the land. This land that we've broken into in prayer last month. We're going to be studying that. Number one key to enjoying the goodness of God. When we're talking about the goodness of God, we're talking about the good things that God gives. Long life, peace, joy, money, children, the things that make life worth living. Number one key to enjoying the goodness of God is willingness. Someone say willingness. Mm-hmm. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 19. Wow, this thing called time. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 19. Please help me. Can we read together? 1, 2, go. If you be willing and obedient, you shall what? Eat the good of the land. Next verse. 20. But if you refuse and what? And rebel, you shall be what? Devoured with the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has what? Has spoken. So one of the keys, there are two keys here now. Go back to verse 19. There are two keys here. The first key is, he said, if you be what? Willing. Someone say willing.
Willing.
Willingness is one of the keys to eating the good of your land. Willingness. Willingness to obey God's word. Whatever you read in the Bible, being willing to obey it. Whatever you hear God ask you to do, being willing to obey it. Whatever you hear God through his servant, because these are the ways God speaks. First, through his word. Second, through his voice. Third, through his servant. Three major ways God speaks to you. First, through his word. That one is general. Everybody, if you read your Bible, you will hear some things. You will hear God. through his servant. If you come to church and listen to messages, you will hear God, because God speaks through his servants. Number three, through his voice. If you spend time in personal devotion, if you spend time in prayer, if you spend time communing with God, God will speak to you. So, one of the keys to eating the good of the land is willingness. Someone say willingness. Someone say willingness. You know, I was watching Kenneth Hagin, you know, recently, because I don't know what the Lord did to me this month. You know, there were so many things I could focus on, but between last month and this month, he was using some different encounters and experiences to weaken some truths in my heart. Because you see, I'm not the kind of person that just want to preach a message so it will be fun. I'm concerned about the welfare of the people. I always look for what I will preach that will affect the welfare of the people, that will give them a better life. That's what drives what I preach. I'm not preaching to get at you, get at your pocket or whatever. Anytime you see us preaching a message, the ultimate end is your good. Tell your neighbor, it's for your good, though. Tell your neighbor, it's for your good, though. So can I even say something, that he was working in poverty for many years. He was working in poverty, his family was working in poverty. One of his cars, in fact, by the time he was through with the car, they sold it for scrap. And the money that he got from selling that car was only enough to pay the interest on three loans. Not the loan, interest on three loans, whereas the loan kept running. One other time, he said his car was so bored that he doesn't drive it in the daytime. He travels only at night when the weather is cool. Because if he drives that car in the daytime, the tire might blow because of heat. So he always moves at night. Can you see that kind of bondage? You know, poverty is bondage. I was talking to my wife today, I said that it's just money that's our problem. A lot of things are life is easy. Are you aware?
Yes, sir.
You know that this life can be easier than this?
Yes, sir.
Is it true?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm struggling, you yourself. Some of you go to market, but I don't know what happened. It's because of the wrong. I won't all day. You won't even be in the market. But for saying happy. So it's a willingness. So when he went to the Lord, I was telling the Lord that I don't understand you. He took this scripture to the Lord and said, Lord, if you say your word, if you are willing and obedient, I will eat the good of it. I will obey you, blah, 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 blah. And the Lord said, yes, you have been obeyed, but you have not been willing. He was shocked. He said, Lord, how can you say that? By the time God opened his eyes to what willingness was about, he started, he repented in 5 seconds. And I said, Lord, I'm willing now. And I'm obedient. So I'm ready to eat the good of the man. So I was always wondering, what did he actually mean? And that discussion with God changed his life. Because from that day, he made up his mind to be willing to do whatever God's word said. And secondly, to obey God fully in every area. Because I'll come to obedience too later. Or maybe I hope I won't forget it. Because when it came to obedience, let me not get ahead of myself. Let's finish willingness. What is willingness? Let's look at what the dictionary calls it. Willingness is readiness to do something. Readiness to what? To do something. Another word for it is eagerness to do something. That means you are prepared. Waiting for the instruction. It's not when they instruct you, you start preparing. Some of us, that's the way we relate to God. We are so unwilling to do anything. That's, you know, it is prayer time. And God maybe wakes you 15 minutes to your alarm. Instead of you to go into your bedroom and wash your eyes and even start praying small, you know what you do? You stretch on your bed more and say, Lord, it is not yet 5. 5, wake me. That is something, but that's unwillingness.
That's unwillingness.
Of course, you know that the next time you open your eye, what would the time be?
Seven.
So I say readiness. So I say readiness. The military language, when we're in staff, they always say, be what? Prepared. Then when you become a rover, they say, be prepared always. Always. So a scout does not sleep with pajamas and other things. You sleep with your clothes, everything by the side. If you see a soldier, they don't sleep with pajamas. You sleep with your gun by your boots by your side. What can you put your leg in the boot? Can to carry your gun? It's only civilians that hang their clothes, hang their shoe, then wear pajamas and start sleeping. When there's an emergency, the first thing, they won't even know which one should they get the clothes or the shoe. Someone say readiness. Willingness is readiness to do something. For instance, some of you come to some services knowing that we'll raise money. Let me enter your 18 year. You have sensed it. You have seen it. You have felt it. You know what they do? The guys sit at the back and be going in and out of the room, hoping that once I'm seeing it, they are outside. It happens to us. But then we go for national programs. We know the day they raise money. All of us know. We just go and sit at the back. Pastors, we sit at the back. So that once they are saying anything, we'll just be going out. That time we'll go out and say, hey, somebody needs prayer. We'll just be praying for emergency. When they say, we're looking for Mr. Okoro. Hey, Mr. Okoro. Hey, Mr. Okoro. Because you know they want to listen. Tell anybody, repent. Readiness. You know they wait money. You should come to that church with your checkbook. Your mind should be made up what you're going to give. That is called willingness. Someone say willingness. A brother is telling you his ordeal. You know he needs money. You know where that discussion is landing. You just interrupt it, or cut it, or circumvent it. Tell your neighbor,
you must be ready to obey.
Yes. Willingness. So it means readiness. Somebody say readiness. Readiness to do something. It involves promptness and eagerness. That means prompt obedience. Because you are ready, once they say, you do it. Who can help us move this pulpit? You are there. But you wait, are they really asking for pulpit movers? Okay, let me listen again. Lord, once you have spoken, Lord, have I heard? Lord, once you have spoken, none have I heard. That is unwillingness. Tell your neighbor, that's unwillingness. It's an attitude problem. Are you aware?
Yes, sir.
And when you relate to God with that kind of attitude, you will not eat the good of the land. You can't get the best from God. So that we have people that walk with us. They walk, they obey, but they're not willing. They can't get the best from us. And you know you are aware when people are not willing. Are you aware?
Yes.
Are you aware?
Yes.
You're aware. The opposite of willingness is reluctance or delay. That's the sign that you're not willing. Delay. You vow, it takes you 10 years to redeem it. You are never willing. You promise to help a brother. He now is calling you per hour. You are not what? Willing. I don't know, some people are like that. They'll promise you help. But to get that help, You want to collect 10,000 naira, use 5,000 naira recharge card. Is that not wickedness? And you expect God to reward you after you say, Lord, I gave, after suffering the person. Tell your neighbor, if you will be willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the land. I wrote here, God rewards us specially for being eager or ready to obey Him. God rewards us for being eager or ready to what? To obey Him. One sign of willingness is excitement. Excitement to give. Excitement to serve. For instance, if we request something that belongs to you, be excited to give it. Don't bone and frown and squeeze face first. You lose the reward. You will still give it though, you will still use it though, but you lose what? The reward. You want to help somebody, do it what? If not, you will lose what? The person will collect the money, he will use it eventually. But you see the blessing that should have come from God. You see, that's why sometimes we give and we don't receive. That's why we help people and we don't get the reward. I just don't want to get into trouble, but you know, okay, I will read the scripture. Because this is what the Bible is talking about in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Are you aware? He said that God loves what? A cheerful giver. Can you put it up? I think 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. Is this verse 7? Give us an amplifier so that we can see. Please, if you can. Every man according as he has. Let each of us give as he has what? Made up his mind and purpose in his heart. Not what? Reluctantly. Or what? Sorrowfully. Or under what? Compulsion. What is the compulsion? They have been talking. We are acting like you are not hearing. They now start commanding. They have lost the reward. Pastor Lord used to tell us those days as pastors. He said, whenever they force you to pay your allocation, you have lost the reward of that thing. Will we get the money or you lose the blessing? Because this is the partnership between God and what? Are you aware? Not reluctantly or what? Sorrowfully or what? Under what? Compulsion. Now the compulsion here is because they've been talking to you and you're not moving and they need that thing. You now see people start commanding you, pushing you. Some pastors even go as far as threatening you. Our advice, pastors, don't do. Just talk. If they don't believe them, God will always find a way. True or false? So that they don't argue to their Wahala that you're the one that made them to lose the reward. Carry the other part together. For God what? Loves. He what? Takes pleasure in. And what? Prizes above what? Other things, and is unwilling to what? Abandon or do what? Without a what? Cheerful, joyous, prone to do it what? Giver. Whose heart is in his what? Giving. If you want to summarize this thing, a willing giver. You see, God loves the person. Takes pleasure when he's passing, he calls the angel. Have you seen Mr. A? Have you seen Ms. Zugu? Have you seen Ms. Okoro? Have you seen Sister A, Sister B, Sister C? Have you seen Sister Gazai? He boasts with you. God loves and takes what? Pleasure in and prizes above what? Other things. So even above the amount of money you gave, It's your attitude that's more important to God. Because the earth is the Lord's and what? The fullness thereof. The money you gave is his own. He said the gold and silver is what? Is mine. So giving him back the money is not the main thing. It's the attitude which you give it. Have you given something to children before? You give them biscuit and you now ask them, give me. Wow. They don't look at you. Is it that body biscuit? Is it biscuit that is your problem? No. The attitude. And most times you rebuke the child, sometimes you even flaunt the child. Because you are teaching him giving. But the most important is generosity. Someone say generosity. Is it a biscuit that you are interested in? You can buy it in cartons. So when God asks us to give, it's not the money that is the most important thing. No. It's our attitude. Someone say attitude. The price is above all things and is unwilling to what? To abandon or what? That means when you have this kind of attitude, you can never be abandoned. You can never be stranded financially. You can never be out of what is happening in the nation. You must always be in the center of affairs. Because God will not abandon you. So God will no longer abandon you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
God is unwilling to do without you. You know there are some pastors, in all the moves of God in their life are involved. Whether it is Holy Ghost movement, whether it is world movement, then God finds a way to put them inside it. Like you look at our pastor, Pastor David Ogoyo, he's always on fire. When it's prayer movement, pastor, fasting, pastor is on fire. Discipleship, word study, cell group, pastor is always on fire. Any movement that passes in the center is the attitude of the heart. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Tell you it's an attitude of willingness. Unwilling to abandon or to do without a cheerful word, joyous. Not when we ask you to do something, you frown your face. Oh, come and help us move this chair. You don't swamp through your face like school uniform. Or we call you on the phone, the way you'll be answering the question, how is your car? Okay. Is it with you? Yes. Can you come and pick me? There'll be silence for 2 minutes. Okay. You have canceled the call. A cheerful, joyous what? Prompt to do its giver. Whose heart is in his what? Giving. His heart is in it. He gives with his heart. When he gives, he gives a portion of his heart. Whether it's fundraising, whether it's thanksgiving, not have the one. Last month, this one. This month, that one. Next month, we are waiting. Why is it regular? God is testing your heart. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes,
he's testing what? He's wanting you to develop an attitude of giving. I know that the world still gives too much. Yes, so if you give to one, so become a giver. It should become your lifestyle. So that means budget to give. Is it not a good thing to do? Budget to give. The best way to give offering is to budget for it. There are things I do every month, partnership. I don't struggle to do it because it's in the budget. I budget to tithe. I budget to partner with Pastor David. I do it every month. I budget to pastor with Pastor Knox. I do it every month. Now I've added a new budget to help people. For about 2 or 3 months now, if I tell you how much I was talking to Mr. Bro, I've spent helping people. And I'm happy doing it. And I don't lack. Once I have a need, like today I had one, I was taking out of the pier. Before I knew it, someone sent something. Before I knew it, one heavy alarm landed. I'm never stranded. Financially, I'm not stranded. In this church, I'm not stranded. Anytime we set our heart to do something, to God. Budget to take care of your family should not be accidental discharge. Men, are you hearing what I'm saying? Budget to take care of what? It should not be accidental what? And give food money willingly. This one is coming from heaven. food money, what? Will not the what you will tell the woman, it will subtract protein from the food. What is the carbohydrates? This money I'm giving you now, count it. Count it. Is it complete? Then count how many days are in the month. Because it is not for one day, it is for one month. Divide it and apportion it. I don't want to hear more awful name. You have removed the protein. You have removed the excitement. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Surprise your wife. Give her extra. Give her more than enough. Is it, Daddy, what is this one for? Anything. You see, that day you'll not be able to recognize her. The way she will manifest. Every time, beans and yam. It's what you are bringing. There's no space in the budget, even for crayfish. Is it a good message? There's no flexibility in this house. There's no flexibility in your budget.
Yes, sir.
Can there be fruit in this house? There's no fruit in your budget. Hello. Women know how to enjoy life, though. If you make the provision. That's for good women, though. That's for bad women, though. No matter how many times you bring the thing, you cannot chop the money. I got it. What happened? Are you asking? Have you gone to market? The price of things change every day. Oh, did you know that your child now uses two pampers instead of one? See, you said I should be feeding Junior. I'm feeding my not to win. You are free in the name of Jesus. Every spirit of Malu Malu, every spirit of Malu Malu. Tell them we're talking about willingness. So, if the man gives you willingly, produce what? I won't talk about another place. There's another place that needs willingness. But I shall not discuss it. We will discuss it in Couples Classic. And everybody said amen. Because it is a very serious issue. You see, it's something God is just opening my eyes to. But as God is opening my eyes, I'm seeing that we are our own problem. No? Are you aware?
Yes.
God is not your problem. Tell me, God is not your problem. So God rewards us specially for being eager or ready to obey Him. But whenever we are not willing, though we enter the land, we don't get to eat the good of the land. There are so many examples in scriptures. The children of Israel saw the promised land. The spies saw everything, even came back with some samples, but they never entered that land because of unwillingness. Someone say unwillingness. They are not excited about the land. They are not willing. They are not ready to fight. Because unwillingness includes you're not ready to fight. You're not ready to is to stress yourself. You're not ready to sacrifice. You're not ready to make any effort. That's kind of unwillingness. So they saw the land. They did not enter. Another person that saw the land they did not enter. Unfortunately, was their leader. Because he was not willing to obey God fully. He allowed people's misbehavior to trigger him in the wrong direction in anger. So God is highly principled. He said, if you be willing and what? Obedient, you will eat what? The good of the land. So because he was not willing, God showed him the land. Climb, showed him. Can you see it? This is where I wanted you to enter. But you will not what? And that's not showing himself. I lie down and die. I wonder how that death was. See, lie down and die. It has happened to a lot of ministers. God will show that this is where you should have been. This is what you should have accomplished. But because you are not willing, I'm sending someone else. But for you, lie down and they die also for you. So be careful, because it can happen to both followers and leaders. And brethren, be careful lest you push your pastor into an unwilling life. Because when the people that pushed Moses into that thing, they kept provoking him, they kept provoking him, they kept provoking him. But I made up my mind, you will not provoke me and make me lose my blessing. Once you are unwilling, enjoy yours. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Is somebody hearing me now?
Yes, sir.
Don't allow somebody's unwillingness make you to lose your blessing. Always murmuring, always complaining, always, you know, look for another person. Are you hearing what I'm saying? If Almighty Moses could miss the promised land because of this, it's a dangerous thing. Tell your neighbor, it's a dangerous something, though. So when you have a member that's always murmuring, always discouraging, you know, change address. If it's yourself, leave the cell. Or encourage the person, if you are the leader, encourage him to join. Or leave the cell for him and then plant another one. Because when I read it today, I trembled. God showed Moses the promised land, they asked him to lie down and die. How was that death? How was that death? The only thing that they allowed him to see, the first part of it, which one, Reuben and Manasseh, and conquered, which was not even the main place. The other one, he asked him to go to the mountain, see it, will not enter. So it's a very dangerous thing to relate with God unwillingly. Lift your hand and say, Father, destroy every spirit of unwillingness in me. Disconnect me from unwilling friends. Disconnect me from wrong influences that fan unwillingness in my life. In the mighty name of Jesus. I'm seeing that I'll have to wrap up around here. If you remember the case of the famine of Samaria in 1 Kings chapter 8, was a terrible famine, and they started looking for the prophet to cut off his head. When the prophet came and prophesied, they break through. They turn around. You know, we don't turn around, is it not? They break through. Many prophets came and prophesied. Because so what did you do with the prophecy? Some of you say, no, not being a cousins. Unwillingness. The prophet told him that food will be cheap. This one, that one. A man that was the king's. The Bible said that the king used to lean on him. I don't have time, but you can put it up. 2 Kings chapter 8. He said, how would this be? Even if God, be careful you putting God in your discussion. Even if God were to open the window, have you ever seen the window of heaven? You are commenting on what you don't know. Somebody was saying something somewhere. I warned him. I said, don't comment on what you don't know. Yeah, pastor. Just stop at the level of your knowledge. Someone was talking about stress, that pastor should manage stress and all that. A guy opened his mouth, toy up. He said, the person saying this is not the pastor, doesn't know anything. I told you, that guy is not just a pastor, he's a Jew and a medical doctor and an old one for many years, a healing evangelist, cripples work in his hospital. If anybody understands stress, that guy understands this. And he has seen his friends die from stress and he's warning you, and you, young doctor, they are saying he doesn't know anything. What do you know? I beat the guy. I said, don't talk about things you don't. When angels are called, when elders are commenting, calm down. I hear what I'm saying. Someone now wrote it. He said, many people out of their zeal divorce wisdom, all to their calamity. He said, if God were to open the windows of heaven, how would this happen? Maybe Elijah would be here. Maybe if it was Elijah, maybe he would have been calm. Or maybe Isaiah. He would have written something. Maybe Jeremiah, he would have gone to weep somewhere. Elisha is, give me. Very mean guy. Yeah, see. You will see it. But what? You will not miss this. That's what the scripture finds it. And the man saw it. Did he see it? Because the king, when the food started pouring like this, the king now made him the head of the place, so he saw it. But he did not eat it. Why? They trampled him to death. So it's not for willingness, man. Hallelujah. Is somebody here now? Sorry, okay, I'm the one that misled you. Oh, yeah, read us. 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 2. How is unwillingness manifested as we round off today? It's manifested as murmuring. One of the signs of unwillingness, murmuring. They ask you to do something, you start murmuring. It's manifested as complaining. Okay, look at this. 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 2. No, go back to verse 1. So I think when he said what God will do, is it in verse 1 he said it? Then Elijah said, hear the word of the Lord. These farmers that people are eating their children. You know, in Nigeria now, this kind of farming is around. I hope you know. So people are giving words of knowledge. I said, don't mind them. Even if God were to become president of Nigeria. Elijah said, thus says the Lord, tomorrow, about this time, a measure of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel. Can you give us maybe another translation that, you know, puts it in something we can understand? Maybe a good, I don't know, message or something. Elisha said, listen, the famine is over. I said the famine is over in your life in the name of Jesus. He says, this time tomorrow, food will be plentiful. I said, this season, in your own house, food will be plentiful. He said, a handful of meal for a shekel. Two handfuls of grain for a shekel. If you go back and read this scripture from chapter 6. You see, they were selling donkey head. Now, what kind of meat is in donkey head? There's no meat there. They were selling pigeon dung, poo-poo of pigeon as food. Why were people eating it? So peradventure they might find some grain inside it. You know, they did it during the Chinese Revolution. Mao Zedong's men and other. They were poo-poo. They would get it, wash it, and extract grains and go and cook it. Okay, you know, if not, go and read about the Red Army. Chinese Revolution. He said, the market at the city gate will be buzzing. See, forget what is happening in Nigeria now. Pastor said we are just in the last 2 years. Something is about to happen to this nation.
Amen.
I say this nation is turning around.
Amen.
But before the nation, you, your own, is turning around in the name of Jesus. So you were here last month, you sacrificed, you gave. I say your life is turning around in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You see this church, you can't recognize this church next year.
Amen.
You can't recognize the car park next year.
Amen.
Because your car will be there.
Yeah.
I say your car will be there.
Yeah.
And it will not be push and start.
Yeah.
If you believe it, shout a living amen.
Yeah.
Wow. Then the attendant on whom the king leaned for support said to the holy man, you know the fear, holy man. You expect us to believe that? That's what people say when you say blind eyes open, they say you expect us to believe that? Trap doors opening in the sky and food tumbling out. And the man who is one on, the man that talks, you know, be careful of men of God that can talk, can level your destiny. He said, you will watch it with your own eyes, he said, but you will not what? Eat so much as what? So, I don't know, go back and help us to find out, get where the thing was fulfilled. That's what happened to unwilling people. He said that the word of the Lord of Elisha, they trampled them out. So, media, help us find it then, please. So, murmuring, complaining, challenging authority, signs of unwillingness, backbiting. So he won't say it in his front, you just go and be murmuring. Dragging your feet. Evangelism. Evangel. 3 hours, we surely won't handle you. So they say, come out for evangelism. I've come out to 3 hours. Just enter a beer parlor. They start one stupid argument to join them. Someone say unwillingness. They say home cell. Don't talk there. Once it's 5 o'clock, you go and sit down in your parlor. About home cell. Would anybody say I did not come out? I've come out of my room. I'm in the cell. Where are the members? Every time you say they are not serious, they are not willing. You are not willing. Because if you are willing, you go and compel people. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Sign of willingness is compulsion. Someone say compulsion. When you are willing to obey the divine instruction, you will push. You will do everything. You will pray. You will give. You will encourage people. The people looted the camp and food prices dropped overnight. A handful of meal for a shekel. 2 handfuls of grain for shekels. God's word to the letter. Verse 17. Then the king got that, you know, when the good part of the word of God can fulfill, the bad one also fulfill. That's why be careful of men of God. That mouth, you see that their mouth, good can come out, bad can come out. Blessing, the same mouth that releases blessing can release what? Be very careful. And what determines how it comes out? Your relationship. The king ordered his attendant, the one that he leaned on support, to be in charge of the city gates. The people turned into a mob, poured through the gates. Reading 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 17. Trampling him to death. It was exactly what the holy man had said when the king had come to what? To see him. I don't know whether he said any of that. Every word of the holy man to the king, a handful of meal for a shekel, 2 handfuls of grain for a shekel, this time, tomorrow, in the gates of Samaria. Is there any other thing? With the attendant's sarcastic reply to the holy man, you expect us to believe that trap doors opening in the sky and food tumbling out, followed by the response, you will watch it with your own eyes, but you won't want it so much as a mouthful. Won't be true. So what the man of God came to what? To pass. What was the problem? Unwillingness. Someone say unwillingness. Can you say, Lord, deliver me from every spirit of unwillingness? In the mighty name of Jesus. So, signs of unwillingness, murmuring, complaining, backbiting, dragging your feet, delaying to respond or to do what has been said, careless execution. Shall they say we should sweep this church? Shall sweeping church? I am. You'll be sweeping the dead back into the church. Say they say we should clean seats. They hold me. Clean seat. We will clean seat today. I tell you are through with the seat. When you're not there, it will stay in. It's better you don't do than to do it with an unwilling heart. It will profit you what? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Learn to serve God with your whole heart. Tell your neighbor, learn to serve God with your whole heart. Willingness is manifested by the speed at which you respond. It's manifested by haste in doing the word of God. It's manifested by joy as you walk. It's manifested by careful execution. It's manifested by you walking and not expecting commendation. So people are walking here, nobody's appreciating me, nobody's thanking me. You are unwilling. Jesus said that a willing person, when he finished serving the master, he said, which of the servants, when he comes back and the master is hungry, will leave him? I said, me too, I'm hungry. He said, rather, you will sit down, you will give yourself and serve your master. And when you are to walk, you say, I'm just an unworthy servant. If you serve and you're always looking for commendation, you are serving what? Unwilling. And you have lost your reward. Are you hearing what I'm saying? No. So, sign of willingness, you don't expect commendation. Sometimes, sign of willingness is that you even reject commendation. They say, thank you, say, no, sir, please don't do that. Sir, no, thank you, sir. Sign of willingness, you don't expect reward. Sometimes, you even reject the reward or return it. That shows you did that thing with your heart, but not doing it for money. Sign of willingness is that you are happy just obeying. You feel fulfilled just what? They say give. You are happy. You give. Whether you receive reward or not, you are happy that you obeyed. They say come out for evangelism. You come out willingly. You are happy that you came out. Whether they commend you or not, you're not waiting for that. As I am here now, I don't know who has ever come and said, Pastor, you have done well as a pastor. I don't wait for that. I'm not interested. I am fulfilled obeying God. Simple and short. One day my mom asked me that question later. How much do they pay you that place? I'm just corner, avoid the question. Pay what? I'm not here for pay, man. I'm not here for pay. I'm here to obey God. And He pays me. But I'm not here for pay. Many times, you see, in this church, I'm the highest giver. God, check the record. You see this church? I am the what? Highest giver. I'm not boasting, but it's a record thing. Any day I miss service, the offering drops. God, ask the admin. Any day I miss service, admin, ask them, the offering drops. If you guys want to prove me wrong, I will plan and miss another service. Then let the offering go up. Then I will confirm that some of you are. But it's true. Amazing. Some of you, maybe once in a while, give something, maybe once in a while. But consistency. Then emergency funds. Most of the programs we do there, I complete my money. At the time I asked the God, why do I always have to put my money? He said, yeah, because you believe in the vision. And they said, put your money where your mouth is. Yes. Because that vision cannot fail. Instead, it will fail. All my employment account, I have done it many times this year. I'm not talking about last year, this year. And I'm not looking for any commendation. I'm doing my job. I'm expanding the frontier of the kingdom. I'm advancing Dominion City here. At the end, I am just an unworthy word. You know, we started the building project, got it to the roofing level. Our pastor didn't come there for one day. We didn't even know the location of the building. Some of you, Pastor, you must come. Pastor, come and walk around it. Pastor, you must supervise it. What did you get? What that plot of land? A man's looking. He didn't come. He didn't need to. When I was coming to start this church, I was not giving anything. The only thing I asked for is a speaker. One speaker. That's all. One speaker, see the church. One speaker, see the zone. 9 churches. One speaker. And the speaker was collected after 2 months. Yes. It was collected. And the day it was collected, that's when we bought our speakers. Willingness. Someone say willingness. I told the Lord, we have raised this and this. I asked him back for this speaker. What do we do? The Lord said, we don't need speaker. And go and buy speakers. Say, why? We don't have money. But between Monday and Wednesday, we raise the money to buy new speakers with stand. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Somebody here, as your heart is changing, you're going to begin to see the mighty hand of God in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say you're going to begin to see the mighty hand of God in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Some of you have been obeying, you know, but the problem, you have not been doing it what? There's a man that the Bible says, he served God, but not with what? A perfect heart. This was the problem. He was serving God, but not what? Stand on your feet. We have clothes. This one is enough. It's something you need to go home and think about. Have I been serving God willingly? You're in a department. Have you been serving God in that department willingly? You have been giving, yes. Have you been giving willingly? You have been attending services. Have you been doing it willingly? Because the Bible says, if you be what? Willing and what? Obedient. You shall eat the food, the good of what? The land. Begin to talk to God. Ask God to change your heart. Ask God to remove every unwillingness. Every unwillingness. Every spirit of unwillingness in your heart. Ask Him to remove it. Ask Him to remove it. Every spirit of reluctance, every spirit of delay, every spirit of murmuring, every spirit of backbiting. I'm not hearing somebody praying. It's not a man. You don't meditate on prayer. Pastor Lord said, don't meditate on prayer. You pray prayer. Open your mouth and talk to God. Cry out to God. So that all your labor will not be in vain. Some of you are laboring so that you don't be in vain. Some of you are not even laboring at all. We will talk about you on Sunday. Reza tokoshita kapatokoshika tapoboshika ba. Reza namakuroboshika rabakuroboshika rabaya. Barobogoroboroboroboshika baya koroboboroboshika ba. Ask God to help you to stop murmuring, to stop complaining, to stop backbiting, to stop dragging your feet when you receive an instruction from God, from God's word, or from His servant. Ask God to help you to stop delaying in obeying God. Delayed obedience is equal to disobedience. Delayed obedience is equal to disobedience. Delayed obedience is equal to disobedience. Ask God to help you to be careful. Some of you are looking around and say, pray, talk to God. This is why you've not been eating the good of the land. This is why you've not been getting the harvest of the seed you have been sowing. Ask God to help you to execute every instruction carefully. Lord, help me to be willing. To obey my pastor, to obey instructions, to obey your word willingly. Ask God to help you to pray willingly. Some of you, your devotion is with a lot of unwillingness. That's why the devil is having his way. That's why he's winning you with steam. Lord, make me willing in my devotion. Make me willing to study my Bible. Make me willing to pray. Make me willing to come to church. Make me willing to hear the word. Make me willing to do the word. Make me a willing giver, a willing soul winner. Please, Lord. I want to eat the good of the land. I want to break out of any renew it and bring it to prosperity. Ask God to help you to do everything you are doing with joy, with speed, with careful execution. Lord, help us to do the things we are doing, not expecting any commendation. Help us to be fulfilled doing what you have asked us to do. Father, we know that as we change our attitude today, our life will change. Our harvest will change. Our results will change. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. And everybody said amen. Did you receive that word?
Yes, sir.
Are you proposing to change?
Yes, sir.
If you will, your life, see, your life will change forever. Say, lift up your hands. Say, Father, today I declare that I am willing and I am obedient. And from now, I will eat the good of the land. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody say amen. Can we put our hands together for the Lord? Let's give him praise. Take out your offerings very fast. Father, thank you for the privilege to give now. Give willingly, okay? Thank you for the privilege to give. As we give today, we give to the advancement of your kingdom, to the work in this local assembly and beyond. We give to touch lives. And Lord, we receive our blessings, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over in Jesus' name. If you have your tithes, come forward very fast. Come forward very, very fast. Father, thank you for your people standing on account of the tithes. So if you are tithing, tithe willingly today. I ask that you bless them, open the windows of heaven over their life. Pour out blessings they will not have room to receive in the name of Jesus. I rebuke every devourer. Whatever comes to scatter when they gather is banished from their life in the name of Jesus. Let your blessings overshadow them and let their lives not be the same again. In Jesus' mighty name, I receive your tithes in Christ's name. Hallelujah. Can we open up the communion? Today, as we take the communion, one of the things you're going to ask the Lord to bring for you, to bring you divine protection. Someone say divine protection. Over your family from now to the end of the year. The second thing we're going to ask is for healing. If you're sick in your body, as we take the communion today, ask God to heal you. If you're oppressed by the devil, ask God to set you free. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And the last thing we're going to ask God is for unusual blessings. I don't know what you're trusting God for. The communion table is a table of fountains. Jesus died to provide prosperity, success, increase, marriage, whatever you're trusting God for. He died. The Bible says this is the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who was rich, but yet for our sake he became what? Poor. That through his poverty we might become what? Rich. The cross was a place of exchange. When Jesus died, he bore your problems, he bore your crisis, he bore your poverty, and he released blessings. I see you entering blessings today in the name of Jesus. So Father, we receive this communion today. Please open. On the night that you were betrayed, you took bread and you broke it. You said, "This is my body that was broken for you and for me." Lord, your body was broken so that our body will no longer be broken. Today, as we take this, we receive wholeness in our body in the name of Jesus. We receive strength, we receive vitality, we receive wholeness. We receive restoration for everything that is lost. Lord, as we break this bread, today we declare that bread will not lack in our lives in the name of Jesus. Doors of provision are open in the name of Jesus. On the way to Emmaus, when the bread was broken, the understanding of your disciples were open. As we take this bread today, we will open our eyes to this message that was preached today. And then it will also open our eyes to other blessings and channels of income as we have been praying in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. The same day, same night, he took the cup and said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood that was shed for you and for me for the remission of sins." He said, "Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Tonight, as we take this blood, we remember the death you died. You died so that we might live. You died so that we might be free from sickness, from disease, from demonic oppression, from the power of darkness, from the power of sin, from the power of hell. Today, as we take this blood, we decree we are free from all these things in the name of Jesus. Today, as we take this, remember the Passover, when by the blood of the Lamb, the doors were secure. As we take this blood, it's applied on our life in the name of Jesus. It's applied on our homes in the name of Jesus. It's applied on our families in the name of Jesus. And we receive divine protection in the name of Jesus. Throughout this period, there will be no loss. No loss of life. No loss of property. No loss of opportunities. Throughout this remaining part of this year, even into the next year, in the mighty name of Jesus. By this blood, every curse is revoked in the name of Jesus. By this form, every speaking against us is revoked in the name of Jesus. By this cup, every evil covenant is revoked in the name of Jesus. As we take this cup, we receive life in abundance. In Jesus' mighty name. Every blood disease is damaged by this blood in the name of Jesus. Whether it's a genotype issue, whether it's HIV or hepatitis B, hepatitis C, even if it's coronavirus, everything that moves in the blood, hypertension, high blood pressure, high blood sugar, whatever it may be, in the name of Jesus, is taken care of. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
blood is against you. The blood is against you. So right now,
speaking against you is silenced by the blood of Jesus. Every controversy is ended by the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Father. I decree that everybody is covered by the blood of Jesus. Our families are covered by the blood of Jesus. No evil shall befall us this season in the name of Jesus. Anyone that rises against us will fall for our sake in the name of Jesus. Any arrow shot in our direction shall go back to the sender in the name of Jesus. At the end of this year, we will count our numbers. None shall be missing. I say none shall be missing. I say none shall be missing. In the name of Jesus, by the preserving power of the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody say amen. Can we give Jesus some praise in the house? Just be seated. Let's just take some announcements. Remember, our family, church family retreat is starting tomorrow. It's a prayer and fasting retreat.